All right, I hope you're all doing well. This is going to be a relatively short recap video from week 8. So week 8 continued our journey in section 3 of the course. So section 3 of the course is essentially about moral duty. We began the course with this idea of being all about you, egotism, and in its most extreme form, radical egotism, where the only thing that matters is you, your desires, your goals, your wishes. And so we explored what that might mean, whether you thought that that was permissible or not, and what the justification for that kind of behavior would be, as well as where's the borderline there. I mean, there could be some cases of egotism where you say, that's acceptable, that's permissible, maybe I wouldn't do it, but it's not necessarily morally wrong. So that was the first section of the course. Second section of the course was all about this idea of beginning with self-interest, beginning with the question of how does this action, or in this course, how does this morality benefit me? But that self-interest then grows into a traditional moral perspective, and that was Pascal. And we are now in the third section of this course where the issue isn't so much whether or not morality benefits me, what do I get from it. Really, here we're focusing on moral theories, and moral theories are systems that essentially say, here's a way to think about how you should act. And this action, this duty, may not benefit you, but it's still what you're obligated to do. So the morality, the moral view, doesn't begin with the question of whether I'm benefited. It begins with the question of, well, how do we make sense of morality? How do we systematically think through right and wrong and then put it into practice? The first case of this was utilitarianism, where essentially the goal is to make the world a happier place. You're included. Your happiness matters, but so too does the happiness of others. And your ultimate goal is to make the world happier, make those affected by your action, your principle, or rule happier. And if you do that, you're a good person, and if you don't, you're a bad person. And you certainly may be made happier in this position, but it's not necessarily the case. The second moral theory we're now studying, or you studied last week, excuse me, is Kant's deontology. So deontology is essentially about duty. And so what this means is that really we're trying to think through certain actions. We're trying to figure out what actions or principles or rules are right no matter what. And the big difference between the moral system that we studied first, which is utilitarianism, and the moral system we're now studying, or you studied last week, which is Kant's deontological system, is that consequences don't matter. It's not important for the deontologist. Whereas for utilitarian, consequences are all that matters. Another way to think through it, for a utilitarian, there's no action or principle or rule that is always totally 100% wrong, no matter what, in principle, can't be violated. So if rape, for example, would provide some greater happiness and that gain in happiness, then it's what you should do. Hard to imagine how that could be the case, but you could construct the thought experiment to justify that. Murder, you know, you might say in certain cases, it produces more happiness than unhappiness. So nothing, no rule, no principle, is absolutely out of bounds for utilitarian, whereas a deontologist says, look, there are certain things that are wrong and you shouldn't do no matter what, no matter the benefit. You know, a good example here for a deontologist is that you shouldn't lie. And even if the lie would be beneficial, even if it's a little white lie that maybe gives someone confidence, you know, or maybe with your boyfriend or girlfriend, that helps them feel better. For a deontologist, no matter the social benefit, no matter the utility, it is wrong. You shouldn't do it. Other examples from Kant's deontology that are absolutely wrong no matter what, don't murder the innocent, that you should be punished if you've committed a violation of the moral law no matter what, even if you were the last person in the world. Keep your promises. Breaking promises is morally impermissible. Do not steal. That would be another one. Do not cheat would be another one. And the way he figures this out is through two basic principles. They're both related to what he calls the categorical imperative. And essentially, The first principle is the principle of universalization, where you take your justification, your action, or your rule, and you say, well, could everybody follow this rule and the rule remain logically consistent and coherent? If they can, then you're good to go. If you can't, then you should not be doing it. So, for example, if I say I want to cheat on a test, I cheat on a test because I want a better grade. But if everybody followed that rule, grades would become meaningless. The second big principle here is the means-end principle. So you should never, no matter what, violate, or you put it like this, violate another human being, which means to use another human being, to think about the human being as something that is beneficial to you, to approach that person, that rational being, as something in terms of what can I get from him or her. If you do that, you're morally wrong, no matter what, again, regardless of the benefits. We talked about another principle, and you guys discussed this in your discussion post, the principle of goodwill. And here's the idea that, look, the good person is someone who does what's right simply because it is right, period, end of story. You're only truly morally good if you do what you do because it's the right thing to do, not because it's beneficial to you, not because you desire it, not because there's some greater social outcome or consequence. The truly good person is one who simply does what is right for the reason that it is right. So, for example, two people could do the right thing, two people could be honest, but one person does it because they see a benefit to themselves, and the other person does it simply because it's the right thing to do. That second person alone is truly good, even though they both performed good actions. The other example that I gave you, and you talked about this in class, or in your discussion posts, is the idea of two students. You know, one student in the example comes to class because he or she loves it. They enjoy it. They like the class, they find it interesting, they enjoy learning. And the other comes to class because it is his or her duty. The second student alone, for Kant, is morally good. Now, that doesn't mean the first student is evil or bad or immoral. It just means that they're not truly moral. They're not fully moral. At best, they might be kind of amoral. Because Kant doesn't see, if you act on desire, if your purpose, if your goal is to gain happiness, or if your goal is to gain some benefit to yourself, or if your goal is to gain some pleasure, or if your goal is to gain some broader benefit to society, all of these goals can change. All of these goals are somewhat subjective. All of these goals could, or at least most of them, could be considered egotistical. So desires, passions, feelings, happiness, all those for Kant are illegitimate foundations for morality, illegitimate intentions to consider yourself truly moral. Again, you know, two people are going to be doing the moral thing, but only one is truly moral. And with that, I'll kind of wrap up this week's recap and move on to natural law morality.